Welcome to the Moms Making Six Figures podcast, where it's all about real women, real stories, real inspiration. And now your host and creator of Moms Making Six Figures, Heidi Bartolotta.
Thank you. So today I am sitting here with Brooke Pollan. Thank you for taking the time to do this interview with me.
Hi, I'm excited to be here.
I'm excited to have you. This is going to be fun. So I thought it would be fun for us to talk a little bit about just your journey in life. You have such an interesting career path, starting out in really health and wellness, and then owning a gym, being a gym owner, and all that that entails in being a business owner, and then moving out of that into a little bit more of a flexible entrepreneurial role.
So a lot more flexible.
Yeah. So let's start with, how did you end up in wellness?
So I think I've always been drawn to the fitness industry. I mean, I remember being a little girl or like in high school wanting to own a gym. Franco's was our big, you know, gym in town. And so I had a passion for, you know, exercise, and my parents were runners and really healthy. But what happened to me is when I went to college, I suffered from ADHD and depression. And really, like, everything that, you know, I thought exercise and health was, wasn't necessarily working at the time. And so it was a blessing in disguise because it really forced me to move to Colorado. I wanted to get to the health industry. I wanted to figure out how to get off these medications. I didn't like the side effects. I didn't love being on them. And they continued to increase the dosage. And so I was kind of going down a path that I, you know, didn't recognize. So moved out to Colorado with like a car and a U-Haul and kind of dove headfirst into nutrition. So I got a job at 24 Hour Fitness as, you know, more in like sales and management, but was able to then go work with a lot of amazing doctors, holistic practitioners, to get to heal myself. And in the meantime, just became super passionate about nutrition and how nutrition heals the brain and the link between nutrition and ADHD and depression. And so the journey for myself, I was able to then bring into my clients. So
why Colorado? I've never asked you that before.
So it was either Colorado or California, because those were the mecca of health. I mean, that's where the most, you know, for example, in Colorado was one of the first doctors who prescribed Armour, which is a natural thyroid, you know. But California and Colorado, just in the fitness industry and health industry, were known as the kind of leaders. And California was a little bit too far away and too expensive. I guess Colorado is really far from the South too. But so, yeah, I mean, it was, I don't know. It was, I think it was just definitely kind of a God-led thing, and didn't know anybody out there at all. And it was kind of a new journey and was going to find myself and maybe move back, and just didn't move back.
And then you found someone and then
wasn't looking. Yeah. And, yeah, so my husband was actually in the pharmaceutical industry. He was a chemist for Rosemont Pharmaceutical and wasn't happy. He wanted to do something with fitness and nutrition. And he, you know, just playing sports his whole life. So he actually worked his way, his clientele in the fitness management role to be able to replace his income. So I got hired at 24 Hour Fitness right when he got, when he came on full time and left his pharmaceutical career. And all I can tell you is a year later, we were opening our own clinic in Evergreen, Colorado. Like, just maybe it was 2 years later, but it was quick. I think we both had the passion to really be able to use our background. So he really struggled in college as well. And exercise and nutrition saved his life. And he wanted that career path. So, but we wanted to do it on a scale where we could really help individually. Mm-hmm. 24 Hour Fitness was still corporate, right? Mm-hmm. And I learned a lot from corporate. I'm so grateful for the sales. I thought I'd go more into the management role, and I went into the sales role right away and learned a lot. It was very, like, not my comfort zone. But we wanted to help people one-on-one. So we opened fitness together. It was one client, one trainer, one goal. And we were up in Evergreen for 11 years in the mountains and learned a lot.
How was that? that entrepreneurial journey is such an interesting one. And I think a little bit different for each person.
Yeah. So, I look back, I was so young. I mean, we were 23 and 25 when we opened the gym. I remember just the stress of getting an SBA loan,
yeah.
You know, $130,000. We actually purchased a franchise because we didn't feel like we had the knowledge to open the gym alone. And it actually, looking back, was one of the best decisions we made. Although, you know, that comes with its own set of issues. But the negotiations on equipment and location. I mean, I was like, oh, we need to go like to where there's a lot of people. I was thinking big gym, and we were more of a boutique. So Evergreen was the clientele that we needed. And to be able to sit down with them and watch them run numbers and really educate us on where to open, that was a huge learning experience. And then watching the negotiations with certain equipment. And we expanded our gym twice since we opened in those 11 years. And that came with new equipment. And so to watch their negotiations and be a part of the franchise, and we respect the franchise, they were not so hands-on. I mean, when you own a franchise, you're still running your own business. Mm-hmm. But the lessons from, I mean, A to Z, I mean, it shaped who we are today. I don't think that we would be successful in our career as successful today if we would not have gone through every piece of owning a business. I mean, it was a huge blessing.
So talk to me about the emotional piece of running that business, because you are very, my understanding of it, and you just said this, you're very hands-on with your clientele. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of personal interaction when you run a gym. You build relationships, I would imagine, right, with most of your clientele, especially a boutique gym. How was that for you coming from a really big, I mean, I know 24 Hour Fitness, they are nationwide, right? And right, they were enormous, going to something like that. How was that?
You know, initially the transition was great. It was refreshing. I wanted to be able to connect. And I think where I struggled with getting help as I went through the process of being on medications and having some mental health issues is I would meet with people and I just wanted to tell them, I know how you feel. Like, mm-hmm. Or I wanted them to tell me, I know how you feel. Like I've done. And I felt like I never got that. It was just, I couldn't get that connection. And just like hiring a personal trainer, I think you really need to interview and know who you're connecting with. So I loved that connection because I couldn't have that at 24 Hour Fitness. It was such a large corporation that we could know our clients and but not on the level. I mean, they became family in the community. I look back now and you don't see it until you step away, but they took care. I mean, we were babies. We were 23 and 25 and we gave to them, but they gave to us. Like it really, I feel like we formed a community. I'm still such great friends with that community, but emotionally it was hard because you took on they came to you. So you know, had to be the line between being professional and being their friend and mm-hmm. still keeping those boundaries when they don't have them sometimes and then wanting to help them too. Mm-hmm. And then the emotion of if they left you. I mean, it was like a breakup, mm-hmm. right? And so, of course, a competition is a great thing. And we would have some that I trained for years and then they go try, you know, that's when Bikram Yoga was really big. They opened a Bikram Yoga studio and that's when group fitness started kind of, you know, CrossFit and that sort of thing. So that emotion was the hardest for me, just that I had built that relationship. And then you take it personally, like, was I not doing a good job? Or in looking back, it was different situations. But
I think it's a business.
Right.
And you're running a business.
Right. And it's like, oh, you're choosing that. Yeah. But all the things, I mean, the marketing mistakes that we made and like looking back at some of the marketing things we did, I was like, Jason, can you believe we did that? But it was all learning and growing and trying. And I remember him running and like we had done these mailers, really professional flyers. And he was, in Evergreen, like they're a couple of miles apart, these houses. So he'd go for a run. And anyway, somebody came and knocked on our door. You can't put those flyers in the mailbox without like there's stuff that we didn't know in our 20s that we look back. And I remember a movie ad that we ran and the emotion of spending that money that we didn't have and it being a flop, like mm-hmm. not just the relationship emotion, but the business emotion or a trainer. Like, you know, we had years where we had trainers where we could actually take a day or two off and the business would make money or maybe go on a vacation. But those trainers would leave you because they wanted to go. And I look back at that as a sign of that we did a good job as well, because you want your leaders to go lead. And so they would go open gyms, or one moved to our, you know, strongest manager moved to California and got involved in the industry. And so, but when they leave, that's so emotional. So sometimes it's very lonely where it's just you and you're hoping that the, you know, the trainers show up. And then there's years where, you know, they're doing an amazing job and they're trying to feed their little boy and you can't pay them enough. Mm-hmm. Those emotions, you know, are, I think, probably right up there with the client is the employees became our families too. It became our family too. And to not be able to, you know, have months where we couldn't pay them, or like when in 2008, 2009, when the mortgage sector collapsed and we had to let some go. I mean, it's heartbreaking, mm-hmm. you know, so there's a
so
lot of emotion.
So let's talk about the finance about that. So you've run a very traditional business that required a lot of capital to get it started.
Yeah.
And you did go through a time period where the economy, I know you took on a lot of the work that you had other trainers managing right. at that point. And what was that like? So you went from six figures in a profession and in a business, and then to watch it like plummet. I mean, like everyone did at that point. It wasn't just you. Everyone was going through it. What was that like?
It was, I mean, I look back at those years and it was probably some of the hardest times of my life, because we were comfortable. We were doing well, and we had worked so hard. And to watch, and I'll give you the statistics, we were training 55 clients a day plus nutrition clients. So we'd be 55 a day plus about 10 that would just seek out nutritional help. Overnight, that number dropped to 13.
Wow.
So if you do the math on that, and they're paying $60 to $80 a session, mm-hmm. that dwindles quickly. So, and we even had a savings. And so we ran through $100,000 in savings. We had to lay off employees. I was now with a second child working more than I had worked before I had kids, just to, you know, turn it around. That was tough. I mean, my husband went through kind of a dark time. I remember him getting up at 4 a.m. and coming home in the evening when the kids were in their pajamas and like just being exhausted. And, we talk about that time a lot because it was also what made us so strong. It also, I have such respect for him because he invested in a Sandler sales program. Him and his manager got together, like they were going to do everything to turn this gym around and in this economy. And there were about, I want to say 22 to 30 franchises at the time of Fitness Together franchises in the Colorado area. And by the end of 2010, we were one of the few that
remained.
And it was really digging our heels in. And we were actually going to purchase two additional locations because one guy was walking away, and we really thought we could rebuild that. And that's really what led to our transition mm-hmm. with what we do today. But it was one of the hardest times. But McKay Christensen said to us, I know we share mm-hmm. love and mentorship with McKay, or he's mentored both of us, but he said, one of the worst things that happened to Brooke and Jason ended up being one of the best things. Mm-hmm. And that is on so many levels, you know. I mean, I look through like, we can do the hard, because that was hard. Mm-hmm. I call Cruz my angel because I have this baby who was just like perfect. He slept, and I'm like, there's no way we would have gotten through those times if I had like a colicky baby, like God knew what he was doing, you know. But we learned so much. Mm-hmm. You know, you have to fall. You have to fail. You have to almost lose it all sometimes to learn, to grow, and to realize that you have the capacity to do it, mm-hmm. like the capacity to dig your heels in and make the sacrifices and, you know, do it for your family. You know, there's a lot to come out on the other side from, or a lot to learn when you come out of it. So sometimes you don't see that you're going to come out, you know?
Yeah.
I was like, what are we going to do? So
someone said on one of the podcasts before that, and I'm going to keep using this quote because I just thought it was so perfect. She said, at the time, it seemed like just a huge boulder in my way. And looking back now, I realized it was a pothole that I needed to learn how to navigate.
I love that.
And I think that so many of us have gone through things that have taught us that we have strength, like we mm-hmm. have the ability to do it, right? So what am I not asking you? We have our listeners are kind of in two categories. We have a lot of probably younger women that are aspiring to six figures. And then we have those that would be our contemporaries where they're at six figures and they just listen because it's other women like themselves. What am I not asking that you think you could share?
You know, I think for the younger generation or younger than us, it's so interesting because we were like the young ones not that long ago, right? Who I'm speaking of. I would, you know, I think we need to talk about not being afraid to fail, mm-hmm. not being afraid to take risks. I feel like these days women are afraid or they're listening to the naysayer. I mean, you know, my husband's father told him, what 40-year-old trainer do you know? We sat down with an accountant in my hometown and basically we were trying to be talked out of opening this franchise, but we knew that it was what we wanted to do. And I think so many times people are afraid to take risks. If you want to make six figures, you're going to have to take risks and you're going to have to fall on your face and you're going to have to realize this is part of the journey. And you will be a stronger six-figure earner. You'll be able to weather the storm because, and this is one of my favorite quotes that I heard years ago. And, you know, everybody that's inspiring to be a six-figure earner, Frank said this. He said, wealth will challenge you more than poverty ever will. Mm-hmm. And I remember thinking, oh, really? Well, let's test that because it doesn't feel real good right now. You know, like that was what was going on in our life. And as you become a six-figure earner and you are accustomed to that and that lifestyle and that you still have to go through a ton of challenges mm-hmm. and your leadership changes and grows. And so you still have to take risks. You still have to fail. And it's harder failing the third and fourth time because you know the emotion that comes with it. You've walked through that darkness once. Mm-hmm. You've had somebody hurt you once. And so it's almost a little bit harder because yeah. you're like, I know what's coming. Mm-hmm. So I would say, you know, be bold, be brave, embrace the failure. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I can say this publicly on your podcast, but it helps me so much. Like, embrace the suck sometimes. Like, sometimes I have to tell myself that, like, you're going to get stronger from this. And I think, you know, this generation's like, I want it tomorrow. Or I'm either too afraid to take the risk or the chance or the jump, or I want it tomorrow. And not understanding that there's so much beauty in that journey mm-hmm. and that you're really young and your greatest years might be in your 40s. And I wish somebody would have told me that.
Yeah, I wish someone would have told me that too. And I also think that who you become and what you learn about yourself in that process is the biggest blessing, more so than the income on the other side of it or yeah. the goal that you accomplish on the other side of it.
Oh, agreed. But you know what's really cool about the listeners in kind of our age group, or not even age group, like just lifestyle-wise, if you're already earning this income, is that you can do it again.
Yeah.
You know, you can reinvent yourself, and there's not an age on that. And I went through that. I went through a period of, you know, we had a lot of success in our gym, and then some failures, obviously, and came through that, and then a lot of success in our current career, and the really fun part now is to figure out how to do it again, mm-hmm. and to be excited about that challenge, and to go. And I've been calling it Act Two. So just to give you a little background on our goals this year, but what have we learned from Act One mm-hmm. and what can we bring into Act Two? What can we let go of? What can we do better? And it's really kind of exciting. Like, I feel more rejuvenated, and I told somebody yesterday, I'm like, I'm just really happy in my business and in my life because it's fun and not being so tied to the immediate results, but really enjoying the process of that, what that looks like to do it again, yeah. what and do it better and stronger, or not even, and of course, what I think it should look like is not what it looks like right now. And I was like, oh, this is part of the learning, but what you do take away from that and learning through that second piece is really exciting, especially at my age, like in my 40s learning from this, I'm handling things so much better. I mean, still have a lot of work to do on a lot of things, obviously, but I'm able to handle things emotionally. I'm able to handle the failures. I'm able to brush things off more. I'm able to go even deeper because I've been through, you know, some of the hard
life.
Yeah.
I've been through life.
Yeah.
So one of the questions that I always ask my interviewees is, do you remember when you hit six figures, and was there an emotional component to that for you?
Well, I remember exactly because, you know, I think any entrepreneur or anybody really working towards those goals, if you've had a vision board, or we actually had a check written out with six figures on it that we kept in my husband's wallet. And, you know, all those little things I remember that we did and we started doing this year, and you kind of go away from that. But, you know, writing out what you want to accomplish and having those vision boards and having those goals. I mean, it was actually at the end of 2010. I mean, we were coming off of our worst, you know, emotionally, financially, just stressful time, and being able to really not seeing it then, but like to really go, wow, that 1 year of really making the sacrifices, of really putting our head down, of really, you know, kind of changing our outlook, even on finances. Like we started really diving into Dave Ramsey. We started, like our faith was stronger. So it wasn't just our business. We kind of got it together in other areas of our life, our parenting. And I think that all led to that six figure piece, right? So it was more than just the income. It was that we had kind of gotten it together on every aspect. And that helped me start to learn more about different leaders and like their disciplines and what they did. And so many have a lot in common of, you know, especially with exercise and nutrition and their discipline. And so I think it was emotional and you felt accomplished, but I don't think we ever felt like we arrived. And I think we also felt like it could be taken away. So let's be smart with it. You know, it was a goal, but also, okay, that's a stepping stone. Let's figure out how to manage it well. And you look, we didn't even do that. Like we learned, you know,
you learn a lot.
Oh, today we're doing things completely different than 2010. But I think sometimes it takes, and not for everybody, you know, people that are listening could be in a successfully discontent situation. They could be in a comfortable situation. For me, it took us almost hitting rock bottom to make some changes, but we're not at that place right now and we're making changes. So I've loved being on both sides of the spectrum. I think sometimes it's easier to put your head down and work when you have nothing
and
you're at no choice.
Yeah.
But you've also seen leaders who choose not to do that and never go further. Now we have this income, we could get comfortable really quickly.
Yeah, you could be very comfortable right now.
And so that has been really fun to go, what's going to make me, you know, step forward in my leadership and growth in a comfortable situation? So that's what we're exploring now.
So books, podcasts, I know you have a ridiculous number of them, but is there one or two that you recommend regularly?
Well, I know you were going to ask me that because I listened to your podcast and I looked on my Spotify and of course this podcast is on my top. So I love seeing your face pop up when I'm searching. I'm a podcast, like I'm a little obsessed. In fact, I probably listen to more podcasts than I read books now. So I'm trying to like balance that because I love books. We'll talk about that. But I love your podcast. I love learning from the guests. I think what makes a really good podcast for me is the learning from the guests, that they pick people that I can really learn from. So I love yours. But two that I'm listening to right now, this is on a weekly basis, is one is Abiding Together. And it's this group of just amazing women that I think I've shared this with you before. I lost one of my dear friends to breast cancer in August, my age, 5 kids, and just a beautiful soul and a very, so much influence on my life. In fact, she's who I called when I was considering adoption. And she said, just do it. You know, she was like, she made being Christian cool, if that makes sense. Like she was just the fun. She was just lovely. And so one of her girlfriends from college started this Abiding Together. And I listened to it really early in the morning. I get up before anybody, like usually like 4:30 or 5, and I have coffee and I listen to their voices. And they're not in the same even like religious affiliation that I am. But I've learned so much. And, you know, I don't agree with everything, but I feel like it's an amazing way to start my day. And I have noticed that I'm setting that alarm earlier and earlier because they, you know, they come from different backgrounds, but they come together with putting their faith first. And so that's been an amazing one for me to follow. And I have to tell you, I love, have you heard of Maxed Out, Ed Milet? Have you ever listened to his podcast? Mm-mm. So I really am drawn to his podcast from a leadership standpoint, from a business standpoint, because of who he interviews. I could probably tell you, and you know, I've been traveling the country in an RV this year with 5 children and a dog. So I at times get to drive behind the whole circus show, which has been beautiful. So I've listened to a lot of podcasts in the last several months, and I love the guests that he has on his show. And they're all either successful businessmen or women in some way, whether it's an athlete or a CEO. But I love hearing the failures. I love hearing what they went through. I love hearing what they had to do to get to where they are today. And mm-hmm. and sometimes it's nice to kind of remember a lot of us came from the same place or went mm-hmm. through some of the same things. So it's one of my favorites. But who really got me into listening to podcasts was Rich Roll. I love the plant-based lifestyle. I've studied a lot about obviously nutrition and mental health, and I love his take. He's kind of like my scientific, like I learn a lot, and then Ed Milet's like my motivation, like you can do it. So I kind of need that. And then of course, like my spiritual in the morning. So I know that's a long answer, but I need all of that because it's got to kind of hit on different parts of my personality to be able to move forward. So I would say Ed Milet and I think it's called Maxed Out and Biting Together is something that I do consistently. And I think when you feed your mind that consistently, you start to live that. You are able to block out the noise. You're able to, because you can I listened to that this morning, or so when something gets thrown at you, having that in your mind, or just had listened, you know, if I just listened to that, that's been really fun. I think it needs to be a staple, and it's something that I start to teach my new leaders, like pick a podcast, here's some that I recommend, and just fill your mind with that every day. Yeah. You know, remember the CDs we used to have?
Yes.
I mean, I would be in the freezing cold. I would leave the gym in the car in the freezing cold. I'd warm the car. I couldn't afford a car that had like a fancy, you know, warmer back then. But, and I would listen to that and I would like, okay, I get back in, finish my work, you know, it resets your mind.
It does.
And we all need it.
Especially now. I think if people listen to more podcasts and
less news,
less Facebook, let's just be honest. No, I think obviously I love Facebook, but I think sometimes we can get caught up with.
Oh, definitely.
And we need to, that's part of business is you've got to be careful what you're reading, what you're watching, what you're eating,
You have to manage your mind. And I think that, you know, to your point with Facebook and mine with the news, there's so much negativity that if you don't decide that you're going to listen to things that are more uplifting and educational and inspirational, then what you get is the negativity, right?
Yeah. And it festers and it sells and it, you know.
Yeah.
I don't think that some of the top CEOs and you know, multi-million dollar female business owners, and I don't think that they're scrolling through social media that's not feeding their mind. Mm-hmm. There's no room for that. And I think that's something we have to really pay attention to and look at because it's so easy to fall into. I don't think they're—and I think about that a lot. I actually read it. I'm trying to think of the— I think it was a John Maxwell book that talked just about that, like almost being disciplined in your schedule to put that in. Like it may not be natural for people. You and I love listening to podcasts. We kind of get excited about that, but we can also not have it scheduled in our day. And now that I have it, like this is what I'm doing first thing in the morning and have it scheduled. Mm-hmm. And some people don't like that. They want it to be more authentic, you know, organic and don't think that's authentic. I think it's just like working out. I mean, if you want to be healthy, and you want to, you know, have a clear mind, exercise, nutrition. This is part of that. It's the same thing. It's being disciplined to do that. If you want to grow your business, if you want to go further in business, you have to be disciplined to do those things. Mm-hmm. And be disciplined to look at what's distracting you and what you're not doing. And that's really hard.
Yeah.
So I'll tell you what I've been doing. And I'm not doing well at it right now. But when I do well at it, it's great. I've been plugging my phone in across the room at night. So that when I get in bed, and this was hard because I love listening to podcasts, right? So if I have it blocked out to listen to a podcast before bed, I'll do that. But then I go plug it in and I make myself read a couple of pages so that I mean, if you're disciplined enough to listen to the podcast and then not go on Facebook or Instagram, that's one thing, but I'm not. So I'll listen to it, put it up, and then get in bed with a book and then go to bed with that positive like mindset of, mm-hmm. It just recharges me for the next day. And so little disciplines like that, I know that sounds so minor, but that can minimize the distraction.
Oh, and it changes your life over time, mm-hmm. right? The quote, to your point with McKay, that I use over and over and over, is the small, consistent activity done daily will alter the trajectory of your life. And it's so true in so those true. Little things. Yeah.
Well, think of the opposite of that. Mm-hmm. Right? I mean, it's your default future. So if you don't do those little things over time and you do the negative over time, like your food choices, you're not diving into doing some of the things that we're talking about, then you end up on the opposite side. So you have a choice, right? Like choose where you want to be. And I think that's such a good thing to bring up, Heidi, because I think people lack the ability. And so this would be like advice to both groups that you're talking about mm-hmm. with your listeners, they lack the ability to see the long term.
Yes.
And it's that you can't look at the immediate. And it's so hard because we still do. I still look at the immediate. Yeah. Like I was talking to you about my month last month and I'm thinking, okay, where's the silver lining here? Was it kind of unraveled? And I really thought it was going in a good direction. But what's the ultimate goal? If the ultimate goal, and for me, is to leave a legacy, mm-hmm. to be able to show my children and grandchildren hard work and what they can do and accomplish. If that's the end goal, then don't be so short-sighted to live in what's going on right now, because you don't know what that's going to lead to.
Yeah.
And I think people get very caught up in that.
Mm-hmm. So let's wrap up with children. Mm. You have a lot of children.
I do. Do you want some for a couple days? We do live near each other now.
And one is adopted, yes. Which is an amazing story. We could do a podcast on in and of itself. But you manage a very, very successful business, and you are a very present mother of 5 children. What would be your couple words of advice on that?
You know, I think it's probably also one of my struggles is that I don't necessarily feel adequate as a mom a lot of times. And I really just like organizing my time with my exercise and our food prep and our business. Actually, it's not natural for me. I have to organize time with my children. So it makes me feel good that you perceive me as present, because it's something I have to really work on. My husband's very natural at being present with the kids. He's very natural at centering. So we've talked about centering. Mm-hmm. And I think, I wish somebody would have told me years ago, like, you don't have to multitask just because you're a mom. Mm-hmm. You don't, like, women, we were touted as, we were such good multitaskers. It's actually what we shouldn't do with our children. And I really struggle with that. So I have had to do blocks in my schedule. And again, it's something I have to work at every day, because I'm not natural at it. And I love to work. I do. I love listening to podcasts. So for me, it's blocks of time. So I've got to feed myself, you know, spiritually and nutritionally, and then my business. And realizing that centering can be 30 minutes or an hour, and you get more from that with your children than if you try to just be present all the time. So to be able to sit down with them and say, these are the goals mom and dad are working on. And that's been really fun. I'm sure you're in that realm now, but as our oldest is 13, our youngest is 4, and to be able to share family goals, like, because we work from home. So mom and dad are doing this because, and this is what we're working towards. And having the conversations of like having a family business one day, or having different businesses that they can be a part of, and watching them learn through us. But a long way to answer your question, it's really focusing on centering and focusing on those blocks of time in your schedule where you can be present and it makes you feel good. And then you can be present in your business because you can't be all things for all people and you can't be cooking and being on a phone call. And that's hard. So we are so scheduled. It's the only way. And when we're not structured and scheduled, let me just tell you, you couldn't even walk in our house. It would be so crazy. And we still have the challenges. It's obviously not going to go as scheduled. And we've been homeschooling this year, which has been crazy. But I feel like the more routine and scheduled our children are, the more they're thriving as well. So centering, blocking out time, sticking to that, putting the phone down. You know, Friday evenings, we have all phones in the basket. And that's hard. But those are things that I think have made me more present in the last couple of years with the kids.
You have no idea how many interactions I get from women that listen to this podcast and say, it was so helpful for me to hear that she doesn't think that she's a great mom. And almost every single one of my interviewees has said that. And I think it's because as women, we have this, I don't know, very false expectation that we're supposed to be perfect mothers, and yet we have all of these other things in our lives that we're supposed to attend to as well, right? But you're really judged on being a perfect mom.
Yeah.
And it's just not possible.
No.
It just isn't. So I love that you said that.
And I think, too, having those discussions with your kids, because I went into motherhood thinking that I had to be. I mean... You know, that's a whole other podcast too, right? So I had a very present mom, but she wasn't in the workforce.
Yeah.
And so, and I admired so much of her being there. And I think a lot of my ability to, a lot of the opportunities that I was presented with was because of my dad's work ethic and her being home. So when I started to have these feelings of wanting to be this career woman, I almost was like, is this okay? Is this, can I do both? I didn't understand how to embrace it in the beginning. And then flip it, right? Now I feel confident in my business. Am I a good mom? Am I giving my children what my mom gave me? Mm-hmm. So it's that internal battle, but you're right. I think so many women just need to take the pressure off and go, if you just sit there and love on them,
yeah,
you know, that goes so much further than what you think is perfect.
Yeah.
We're really hard on ourselves. Mm-hmm.
Thank you for spending this time with
me. You're welcome. I love you and I love this podcast. And you've been an incredible mentor to me, just watching you, you know. And I think that's what we do. We watch each other and I'm like, oh, Heidi's like this amazing mom. And she, you know, you don't hear the struggles. And you've been somebody that in my dark times, I will look at what you've done and your success and how you handle things with grace, and I can pull myself out of it. So I appreciate you. I don't think you realize, you know, you're this very quiet, humble leader, but you're I would say Heidi packs a punch, because you do. You've got this way about you, and we need that. We need more of those women that we look up to that push us in ways to not only look at things differently, but to kind of get out of our own way and out of our own comfort zones. And so you've definitely been that for me a lot in the last few years, for sure. So
thank you. You've been the same for me. I think we really have pushed each other a lot over the years, which has been a huge
fun
blessing
too.
Yeah.
We should do it again.
Yeah.
Thank you for listening to the Moms Making Six Figures podcast. If you enjoyed this podcast, please take a moment and leave a review on iTunes. To learn more about Moms Making Six Figures, head over to momsmakingsixfigures.com. That's right, momsmakingsixfigures.com.